everyone. Thank you for joining us tonight for Racial Capitalism: Who Benefits from Cultural Appropriation? A conversation with Jeff Chang, Wendy Redstar, and DJ Rekha, moderated by Hrag, Vartanian. This program is presented in partnership between the Shelley and Donald Rubin Foundation and Asian American Arts Alliance, a 2020 Art and Social Justice grantee of the Rubin Foundation. My name is Sarah Reisman. I'm the executive and artistic director of the Shelley and Donald Rubin Foundation based in New York City, where we've supported art and social justice through grant making for the last 25 years. And since 2015 at the Eighth Floor, where we've been organizing exhibitions and public programs that address themes of social justice and political import. And a quick plug for our current exhibition, To Cast Too Bold a Shadow, is an exhibition on misogyny, feminism, and gender, on view by appointment through January 23rd. Viewing of the exhibition adheres to COVID guidelines. We'd love to host you for a distance visit to the gallery, the Eighth Floor. To make an appointment, go to www.theeighthfloor.org/visit, where you can reserve a spot. Before we begin, please note this event has closed captioning provided by Mirabai Knight and ASL interpretation by Jessica Ames and Alana Aloy. Instructions are in the chat section. For those who wish to access closed captioning, when the captioner starts writing, the CC button appears for viewers. Typically, this will be visible at the bottom of your Zoom pane. Viewers can then click on subtitles next to the CC button to show captioning and then choose show full transcript to have the full transcript appear on the side of the screen. For ASL interpretation, when we're screen sharing, please click on the visible interpreters box and click the three dots in the corner, then select pin video. If you have questions throughout the conversation, we advise that you use the chat function to submit your query. During the panelist conversation, we'll read off the questions read off by our moderator. After the Q&A begins, you'll be called on and unmuted, I think. If you prefer to have your question read by one of us, please make a note alongside your question in the chat section. Also note, this event will be recorded and will be available early next week on our many social media platforms. So just some background on tonight's conversation. In an increasingly globalized world, and one that is simultaneously localized in the context of COVID, parts of our individual sociocultural identities tend to be influenced by cultures that are not our own. So how do we make sense of this phenomenon in our individual creative practices? And what distinguishes appropriation from influence? Who has the right to tell the story of a culture? And who has the right to profit from cultural references? In the last 5 years or so, these questions have become more and more prevalent. We're lucky that moderator Hrag Vartanian has agreed to lead the discussion with Jeff Chang, Wendy Redstar, and DJ Rekha to unpack the power dynamics and value structures inherent in capitalism as it relates to culture. This program is a second of a three-part series presented by the Shelley and Donald Rubin Foundation and the Asian American Arts Alliance. Now I'd like to take a few minutes for a land recognition to acknowledge our respective relationships to place. We are gathered virtually in many locations at once. I have no idea where, but I'll note that some of us are in Manhattan, others are in the boroughs of New York City, places that are mostly, if not all, unceded lands. As this event is co-organized by the Rubin Foundation and Asian American Arts Alliance, I'll address the specific sites where our offices are located. So that would be near Union Square and in Dumbo, Brooklyn, as well as the other boroughs of the city, therefore acknowledging the Munsee, Lenape, Canarsie, Matinacoc, and the Wappinger communities, past and present, as well as future generations. The Shelley and Donald Rubin Foundation and the Eighth Floor acknowledge being founded upon exclusions and erasures of indigenous peoples, including those whose land where the foundation is located. This acknowledgement verbalizes a commitment to a process of working to dismantle the ongoing legacies of settler colonialism, a commitment that's become all the more poignant in this time of political upheaval and resistance that have resulted in transformative activist engagement across the country. To this land acknowledgement, I have to add a paraphrased virtual land recognition using language devised by Jill Carter, a professor in the Indigenous Studies and the Drama, Theater, and Performance Studies departments at University of Toronto. So Carter explains, Zoom has erected its headquarters in San Jose, California, while Skype has erected one key arm of its operations in Palo Alto, California. This is traditional territory of the Mukwekma Olone tribal nation. Current members of this nation are direct descendants of the many missionized tribal groups from across the region. We who are able to connect with each other via Zoom and Skype are deeply indebted to the Mukwekma Olone people as the lands and waters they continue to steward now support the people, pipelines, and technologies that carry our breath, images, and words across vast distances to others. So thank you. Now it's my pleasure to introduce Lisa Gold, a longtime friend and colleague, and since 2018, Executive Director of the Asian American Arts Alliance, A4, sometimes referred to as A4. In the most recent cycle of Rubin Foundation grantmaking, A4 was awarded support for an anti-racism program geared towards culturally specific communities rather than white-centered organizations. A4 participated in trainings like Race Forward's Racial Equity in the Arts Innovation Labs and Americans for the Arts National Arts Service Organizations Working Group. And I'm just citing what was in their proposal that some of the participants affiliated with A4 found that these workshops tended to be centered on white leadership confronting their own unconscious biases and how people of color can confront white supremacy. But the workshops generally didn't address the racism that can take place within and between specific communities of color. For example, anti-Blackness in the Asian community and xenophobia toward immigrant communities. Considering where we are in the year of the global pandemic, Rubin Foundation's grantees were encouraged to adapt their original proposals to meet more emergent needs, of course. After conversations with Lisa over the summer, we decided to organize this virtual series relating to questions raised by A4's project proposal. And here we are in our second session. Having been privy to the discussion leading up to tonight with some of the panelists, I'm very excited to listen in with the whole group, Wendy, Hrag, Rekha, and Jeff, all together. I hope you'll join me in welcoming Asian American Arts Alliance and our panelists, and I'll turn it over to Lisa. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sarah, and to everyone at the 8th Floor and the Shelley and Donald Rubin Foundation for this opportunity. Quick accessibility check. I am a Hapa woman with half Korean, half white, with dark brown shoulder length hair, wearing a red shirt. And I am speaking to you from unceded Lenape and Canarsie lands on the Lower East Side of Manhattan. For those of you who aren't familiar with A4, we are a 37-year-old nonprofit organization dedicated to ensuring greater equity, representation, and opportunities for Asian American artists and arts organizations. We offer events that build community through events such as our bi-monthly town hall and monthly AAPI arts leaders roundtables. We provide professional development programs and access to cultural gatekeepers through events like career workshops, a virtual residency program, career roundtables, and we create a platform to discuss issues related to Asian American identity through our conversation series, of which this is an example. I'm really thrilled that we are able to present this series with the foundation. And just, I wanted to share a little bit more about its genesis. I think Sarah did a very nice job of framing it. And I just wanted to say that, to reiterate that when we were devising this, the team, the A4 team, found ourselves discussing the issue of bias within our own community. And as she stated, that almost all of this discussion that was happening around us, this talk of oppression, racial equity, DEI training, was very much from the perspective of diversifying white-centered spaces and did not really address the issues that we were experiencing. So we wanted to bring together Asian Americans and other BIPOC artists and organizations to work together on programs to build mutual understanding and address some of these hard issues. So as Sarah noted, then you know, COVID hit, so our programs were upended. And then, of course, the brutal murder of George Floyd, which was painful on many levels. But I, you know, the thing that brought me back to this need for conversation was that I could not escape the fact that one of the officers involved in this extrajudicial killing of George Floyd was an Asian American. And so it just reaffirmed the need to have these really challenging conversations. So I am so grateful that we have these incredible thought leaders with us tonight to interrogate these really difficult ideas And before I introduce the panelists, I just wanted to let you know that we'll be sending out a survey to all of the attendees tonight, and we would like you to please respond with your thoughts and comments, because we hope that this is just the beginning of a conversation series and that we can continue to explore these concepts. So we want to know what you want to know more about, what your thoughts are. So we appreciate your feedback. And then, as Sarah stated, we will have a brief Q&A after the panel discussion. So I will field the questions, and you will be unmuted so you can ask them directly to the panelists if you choose to. And I may, just so you know, I may group the questions together so that we can get to as many as possible. And now, with great pleasure and immense gratitude, I would like to introduce tonight's panelists. First off, Jeff Chang is the Vice President for Narrative, Arts, and Culture at Race Forward and the co-founder of online publications Culture Strike and Color Lines. His books include Can't Stop, Won't Stop, A History of the Hip Hop Generation, Total Chaos, The Art and Aesthetics of Hip Hop, and Who We Be, A Cultural History of Race in Post-Civil Rights America. His latest book, or collection of essays, We Gonna Be All Right, Notes on Race and Resegregation, was published in September of 2016. It was named the Northern California Nonfiction Book of the Year, and the Washington Post declared it the smartest book of the year. And I will add that it deeply influenced the development of this discussion series. Next, raised on the Absaluka Crow Reservation in Montana, Wendy Red Star's work is informed both by her cultural heritage and her engagement with many forms of creative expression, including photography, sculpture, video, fiber arts, and performance. An avid researcher of archives and historical narratives, she seeks to incorporate and recast her research, offering new and unexpected perspectives in work that is at once inquisitive, witty, and unsettling. Next, DJ Rekha is a producer, curator, and activist who pioneered Bhangra music in North America via their long-running monthly nightclub series, Basement Bhangra, which I miss. They are on the board of a Queens-based Chaya Community Development Corp, serving New Yorkers of South Asian origin. And they produce the weekly podcast, Bhangra and Beyond. And now, of course, last but not least, our moderator tonight is the editor-in-chief and co-founder of Hyperallergic. Hrag Vartanian is an editor, art critic, curator, and lecturer on contemporary art with an expertise on the intersection of art and politics. Hrag co-founded the publication Hyperallergic in 2009 in response to changes in the art world, the publishing industry, and the distribution of information. I turn it over to you, Hrag.
Great. Thank you so much. Thank you for that wonderful introduction in general. And I just wanted to say it was really I think it's the first time I've done an event like this where it was also acknowledged the technology and the sort of the fact that where the technology is headquartered, which I think is really important for this conversation we're going to have about cultural appropriation, because I think there's so much complexity about also the channels that these are being propagated on. And so I just want to sort of bring that into the screen or room, as it were, to sort of like just make sure there that that's an important part of this conversation. I also wanted to sort of just build on, in the case of George Floyd, as someone who's also who's a Middle Easterner or Swana, for some of you may not know, Southwest Asian, North African, the person who called, or the person whose business called the police on George Floyd, was a Middle Eastern American. So, you know, I think I just want to bring that into the room to sort of like understand how the complexity of this issue might sort of bring in. And I hope, Jeff, at some point we can talk a little bit about the in-betweenness that comes up in one of your books about race and resegregation, and how, you know, I think sometimes conversations about cultural appropriation tend towards the extremes, like either it is or it isn't, and not understanding how they're much more complicated issues. So I just want to also sort of bring that in, because I think particularly around issues of anti-Blackness and cultural appropriation, there's certainly a lot of in-betweenness that happens with groups that are not are not Black. So I wanted to start a little for those of you who may not know the term racial capitalism. It's something that perhaps has entered your consciousness more recently. I wanted to read two definitions just to sort of start us off. And I also want to invite people, if you have any questions, please feel free to, during our conversation, bring them into the chat so that we can just sort of address them as they come up. So I welcome that. So the first definition is very short from Nancy Leung from Harvard Law Review. This is it was an article from the about race in law. And the definition she used, racial capitalism, I just want to read that, the process of deriving social and economic value from the racial identity of another person. Just thought that was a very short, clear one. And then another definition by Robin D.G. Kelly, and it's regards to Cedric Robinson's definition, which of course some of you may know. Robinson was the person who came up with the term racial capitalism. And his description of the term, just you bear with me, it's a few lines, but I think it's important so we have a starting point for this conversation. Robinson challenged the Marxist idea that capitalism was a revolutionary negation of feudalism. Instead, capitalism emerged within the feudal order and flowered into the cultural soil of a Western civilization already thoroughly infused with racialism. Capitalism and racism, in other words, and this is what he's challenging, did not break from the old order, but rather evolved from it to produce a modern system of racial capitalism, dependent on slavery, violence, imperialism, and genocide. Capitalism was racial not because of some conspiracy to divide workers or justify slavery and dispossession, but because racialism had already permeated Western feudal society. The first European proletarians were racial subjects, such as Irish, Jews, Roma, Gypsies, Slavs, and they were victims of dispossession, enclosure, colonialism, and slavery within Europe. Indeed, Robinson suggested that racialization within Europe was very much a colonial process involving invasion, settlement, expropriation, and racial hierarchy. So I just wanted to start there just so that we have a bit of a ground to start from for those of you who may not know. And again, if there's anything that we've talked about, please feel free to sort of chime in. So I wanted to start with one specific example that I wanted to bring in the room, because I think it brings up some of the complexities of what this issue is and why some people don't quite understand when it happens. So I'm gonna ask if the image of Kimono Wednesdays could be placed on the screen so people can see them. So Kimono Wednesdays, for those of you who may not know, occurred at the Museum of Fine Arts in Boston. And this was a case where a very famous Monet painting, which you can see in the background, of the artist's wife wearing a kimono. Well, in this case, one of the interesting things about this is there were a series of protesters. If you can see the other image with the protesters, please. So people were invited to don the kimono and sort of take photos or selfies or anything they wanted in front of the painting in the museum. A series of Asian American protesters started a protest movement against this, as you can see right here. But there was a lot of confusion around this, why it was cultural appropriation, why it's not. And I invite the panelists to address this, but I want to give a little bit of a background, which is the kimono was actually commissioned by a Japanese TV company, NHK. And I think the fact that it was coming from Japan initially as the idea, there was this idea that it was it came from Japan, it's not cultural appropriation. Not understanding that, obviously Asian Americans have a whole different history. Certainly a lot of them are not from Japan, as well as the fact that, here there's a whole different history and a different way that it's presented. But I wanted to read a quote from Ryan Wong, who wrote something on Hyperallergic back when the protest was going on, that I think sort of encapsulates some of the thinking, which was the protesters decided that this was not cultural exchange, but the exotification of an object for publicity. So I wonder, Jeff, would you like to sort of weigh in a little bit? I'm sure you've probably heard of this instance, but Can you sort of illuminate what you think some of the complexity around this issue and why people have a hesitation around sort of calling out this kind of cultural appropriation? You're on mute, I'm sorry.
That's good, because I was just repeating the question to myself and puzzling over. And of course, you start by asking me the hard question, so thanks, Rob.
Well, it's because you're so good at this. We want your wisdom.
No, flattery will not get you anywhere at this particular point, sir. first of all, I just want to say, I should ground myself and say aloha kakou, o Jeff Chang, ko'u inoa. I come originally from Hawaii, which are the lands conquered by the U.S., taken forcibly. And I'm calling in here from Chechenyo Ohlone land, Miwokmo Ohlone land. The first thing to say is this is a difficult issue because ideas travel, right? So let's kind of set this up, right? Ideas travel, people are inspired by ideas, they flow, right? Especially, certainly, you talked about technology in this type of environment, they're flowing faster than ever. And at the same time, these flows are crisscrossed by power relations. And so appropriation, when done by people in power, looks very different from appropriation when done by people who have had their cultural practices, their languages erased, marginalized, taken away, right? So I learned everything I think I need to know about appropriation from hip hop. Hip hop is a form that freely has traversed cultures. Is, you know, at the big story, of course, like the DJs, Kool Herc, Bambaataa, Flash, taking records from wherever they could, mixing it all up, right? Putting it into this mix, matching the beats, layering them on top of each other. And this sort of being a metaphor for this sort of beautiful post-racial kind of polyrhythmic, polycultural kind of ideal. But in this particular case, when you have an exhibition, right, that's traveling from Japan to the US, it's moving into a completely different type of context. It's going to be seen in a different way because of the context that we live in. And it's going to have an impact on people based on the kinds of power relations that have been set up. And so it looked, I think, to many of the organizers and activists as an act of cultural injustice, right? This was a way in which the dominant culture could continue to marginalize, could continue to suppress, could continue to erase Asian Americans. And I think that that's why you saw the protests occurring. And maybe I'll stop there because we're gonna have a long, rich conversation. Yeah.
That's a great point. And I just want to bring to people's attention the Anne Anlin Chang's book, Ornamentalism, for those of you who may want to learn more about sort of like the representation of Asiatic femininity and sort of visual culture and sort of all the different sort of tropes that kind of go along with that. I wonder if Rekha or Wendy have anything they want to add about this, because, you know, this is also about museum spaces and maybe the way people feel like they would like to be represented, or also the you know, what is challenging and what isn't, because I think sometimes in cultural spaces, we have this illusion that, you know, oh, well, nuance is so great because it's going to like bring out up all these issues, not realizing there's a power dynamic already there. I wonder if either of you'd like to talk about any of that. Yeah, Rekha, go ahead.
Sure. I think Jeff brings up a really good point about the power. Gotta always fight the power. And in terms of context, this exhibit reminds me very much of another activity that happens in New York called Turban Day, which is Sikh Americans gather in Times Square and they're tying turbans, and anyone can sit there and get a turban tied. And it's supposed to be like pride, it's like education, it's cultural education, but the same community post 9/11 was distinguishing their turbans from Muslim Americans, or distinguishing themselves from Muslim Americans who do not tie turbans, but perhaps in some contexts do, to sort of distinguish themselves. So the idea that this is the only group that ties a turban, it's in Times Square, it's a display. So the context really does matter. And this act happening in a museum space, for who is the audience, is a question, who's consuming it. Similarly, it's like a very short, it's a shortcut to a, it's a fast track to being, you know, how do I get to be X, or how do I get to be down with a culture? Well, let me put a piece of physical cloth on myself, or let me like eat something or taste something or feel something. And it sort of disregards all that baggage that comes with it, or it decontextualizes it, actually, is what it does. So that's my thought on that for so I'll stop there.
Great point. Wendy, I know you have an unusual story related to this, so I wonder if you wanted to share that.
Yeah, I really love hearing the word context, because it's so important, especially when you're working with like cultural materials. And I often feel that way with any museum that has a collection of Native objects, especially me knowing about my culture's objects, which I'm Apsaluga, and seeing them on display and knowing that whoever is viewing that doesn't know anything about the Apsaluga people is only getting like probably like, I don't know, 95% of what that object is, because it's out of its context. But yeah, I have an interesting story. I made this piece when I was in graduate school called The Four Seasons, which I really want to protect it. It's sort of like its own entity. So I don't want this to be its story, but it's because it's taken off so much, it's sort of had all these epic adventures. And so this is one of its adventures. It was in a traveling group show, and it happened to be in a show about land, and there were other Native artists in it and white artists. And the piece is actually talking, it's faux dioramas that I made, and I'm sitting in these dioramas in my traditional Crow outfit. And really, I wanted to sort of capture this feeling I had when I went through the Natural History Museum when I was in graduate school, looking for some Crow material, and realizing that the audience who entered into that space had been set up to think that everything is extinct in there. And so I wanted to talk about the way that institutions represent Native bodies and objects. So anyways, this piece was in the show at this institution, which is in California. I won't name the institution. But I went there and I did a lecture, and the show was happening. And I happened to go to sort of like a little cocktail hour after my lecture. And there was docents that were there. And these were docents for this institution that were really their patrons, and then also did docent work. And so one of the docents was so excited to talk to me, because she said they had recently had their docent training and they wanted to do something really exciting for this docent training meeting, where they would dress up as the artists. And so she proceeded to like show me her image on her cell phone, which wasn't her, it was another docent. And this particular docent was an elderly white woman who had dressed up as me, but not like this. She dressed up as me in The Four Seasons on like a bearskin rug. And I'm not even on a bearskin rug in The Four Seasons. I'm on some AstroTurf. But she dressed up as me. And the docent was just so excited to show me. And she said that the woman had won the whole contest. And before I could even really have a reaction, she left. And I was supposed to do some train, another program with them the next day. So frankly, I was really shocked. I take a while to process things, especially like that. So I went back to my hotel, slept on it, And then I woke up and I was like, that was really effed up. Like, I realized that was not, that didn't feel good. And so when I was picked up by the museum staff the next day, they asked me how things went last night. And I said, well, this interesting thing happened. And I mentioned what had happened, and the two staff sort of looked at each other and realized they kind of had, like, excuse my language, an oh shit moment where they actually knew about it. And then I realized that they knew about it. And I said, wait a minute, you knew about this, but you didn't do anything before I came to correct it. You know, I wouldn't have even known about it if you would have recognized that it was an issue. And they said, well, you know, their docents kind of do their own thing. And that's when I realized that, oh, you know, these are patrons to the institution. And so it's like their purse strings. Needless to say, sort of like the shiny part to the story is that the curator who was traveling that show from a different institution, I told her, and immediately she had the work removed. But it's a scary situation to have docents who are supposed to be the educators of that particular exhibition, and they're playing red face. So, yeah. So I don't know how it's close to that, Hrag, but yeah.
Well, I mean, I think that's also brings up the point that Jeff made originally about the power, right? The fact is, when you realize who these docents were, things were a little clearer, understanding maybe the power relationship there. Now, as the artist in that situation, I guess, you know, what kind of mechanism, have you ever thought about what kind of mechanism there should be for this not to happen? I mean, obviously, the, you know, we can't go around educating everyone all the time, and it's certainly not your job, you know, but is there, have you thought about what could happen, or maybe something you ask for beforehand? Is there, has been, have you thought about those at all?
Well, I mean, that's not even the worst part of the story. The worst part was that the museum and the director actually asked me if I would come back and I would educate the docents for them.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And yeah, I think it's very traumatizing, that situation. And I also think, like, how much does that suck that you would have to ask an artist of color to sort of think about these things first, combat them first, you know, like, this might happen, and then approach the institution and say, hey, just in case someone wants to play red face, here's the plan to move forward. No, for me, it's like, I just need to really know where the work is showing, and be more strategic about that and get to know. In this case, it was a little bit harder because it was a traveling show. So it was showing at multiple institutions.
Well, it sort of brings up the issue of, like, even when you're the maker of the object, your objects get decontextualized often, do you know, in a way like this. So Rekha, I'd love to bring you into this conversation. Right. If you wanted to share your clip. Oh, I'm sorry, Jeff, go ahead.
I just want to add something really quick, right? Which is maybe to, like, do the context thing even more, right? Which is to talk about the rise of museums in the mid to late 19th century in the US, right? As part of a project of preserving whiteness, like, happening at the same time that the so-called Indian Wars are happening at the same time that colonialism is happening in the Pacific and in the Caribbean, happening at the same time that the movements that are developing to exclude Chinese are all happening at the same time that Reconstruction is being destroyed and the KKK is rising, right? All of this is part of a project. Like, museums, the sort of museum project is a project to preserve whiteness. And this is the stuff that gets decontextualized. Like, we can talk about our work being decontextualized. What we don't talk about enough is that this is the context of museums that we're talking about, right? So when we come now, when I do, for instance, these racial equity, racial justice, cultural justice trainings these days, we have to take people back to this, right? We have to be able to put that back in and say, look, this is like 400 plus years of the slavery and the genocide and the cultural attacks and the cultural injustices that accompany and justify all of that, right? So this is where artists of color, Black artists, Indigenous artists, artists of color are dealing with this particular kind of situation. So people are like, oh, why would these folks show up in the gallery around this kind of stuff to protest a kimono type of thing? And you and like we sit here laughing now because we're like, we know this history. We know this history that's been decontextualized, that's been taken off because whiteness is made to be transparent. It's made to be not there. Right. And so all these levels that we have to fight come up, and it's just sort of it's just God, Wendy, that's just
I know. Great point. And just to build on that, Jeff, I just want to sort of recently this year, Ariel Azoulay's book, Potential History on Learning Imperialism, she makes a great point. That people often talk about museums as if they were inevitable. And she says actually often we might want to think about the fact that museums were made because of colonialism, meaning like they were made to contain the objects that were looted. And there were so many of them, right? They needed to put them somewhere. So that's also another piece to this. So museums aren't some kind of inevitable institution in the way they've sort of been made to sort of encapsulate human knowledge, right? They were done for a specific reason. So Rekha, I'd love to go back to you. And if you wanted to show your clip, so we could talk a little bit about that.
Sure, before we go to my clip, back to the museums.
Please.
You know, I think then that protest is a way to interrupt whiteness as well as it is to interrupt the art. And I also think, and that is, if I'm not mistaken, the museum where some African American youth were stopped on a school trip. and museums have become such a focal point, or such they're so inserted in education as a cultural tool. And as artists, you know, some of us are, we talk of, let's just put capitalism in, you know, it's like their source of income. And they provide some, so it's a complicated relationship on the artist side as well. But let's get to some music videos. So.
ਸਟਾਈਲ ਚੱਲ ਕਰਦੇ ਆ ਗੱਭਰੂ ਆਪਣੀ ਲਾਈਵ ਦੇ ਆ ਆਪੇ ਕੁੜੇ ਬੌਸ ਆ ਪਤਾ ਹੀ ਤਾਂ ਫਰੀ ਸਟਾਈਲ ਚੱਲਦੇ ਆ ਗੱਭਰੂ ਗੋਲਡ ਦੀਆਂ ਚੇਨਾਂ ਨੇ ਡੂੰਘੀਆਂ ਗੇਮਾਂ ਨੇ ਕਾਲੀਆਂ ਗੱਡੀਆਂ ਕਾਲੀਆਂ ਬੁੱਢੀਆਂ ਗੋਰੀਆਂ ਮੇਮਾਂ ਨੇ House arrest bande back from the hell bande kai underground te kai non well bande head to toe full tattoo ana less hai kali vich rehn te punjab di padesh hai jeban vich cash hai te tikhe mush tash hai mukk di a gall munde lende puri aish hai dekh la de sanja wale di ni puri aish hai babbe di a mer challe geet touch wood ne
ਬੁੱਧੀ ਕਹਿਣ ਵਾਲੇ ਇਹੀ ਸਮਝਦੇ ਆ ਕਿ ਇਹਨਾਂ ਦੇ ਪੱਲੇ ਕੱਸੀ ਵਾਲੇ ਖਾਲ ਤੇ ਰੌਲੇ ਵਾਲੀਆਂ ਵੱਟਾਂ ਨੇ ਪਰ ਇਹ
ਗ੍ਰੇਟ
ਗ੍ਰੇਟ ਸੋ ਦੇਰਸ ਅ ਲੋਟ ਗੋਇੰਗ ਔਨ ਇਨ ਦੈਟ ਵੀਡੀਓ ਜਸਟ ਟੂ ਕੰਟੈਕਚੁਅਲਾਈਜ਼ ਇਟ ਅ ਲਿਟਲ ਬਿਟ ਦ ਵੀਡੀਓ ਦ ਸਿੰਗਰ ਇਨ ਦ ਵੀਡੀਓ ਇਜ਼ ਦਿਲਜੀਤ ਦੋਸਾਂਝ ਸਮਵਨ ਨੋਜ਼ ਇਟ ਕੈਨ ਡ੍ਰੌਪ ਇਟ ਇਨ ਦ ਚੈਟ ਹੀ ਇਜ਼ ਆਈ ਵੁੱਡ ਸੇ ਦ ਬਿਗੇਸਟ Punjabi singer there is. He's huge, he's massive, he's crossed over into Bollywood, Punjab, India to be specific, and he's actually been very important here. There's a huge, like the world's largest protest is happening right now in India. Over 250 million people are protesting for farmers, which is a whole other topic. But the video is really interesting to me because we have a brotherhood being on display, We have Dildito Sanj. He's obviously in Cali. And there is a larger history of Punjabis and farming in California. But there's a lot of misogyny in that video as well. Because just to translate one of the lines, it's almost like when he's posing with the white women, he rhymes like black cars. We have all these things. He's showing also the tracker for when you're released, the device when you're under house arrest. So, I mean, he's touching on all these things, and this video is recent. It came out not that long ago. It really triggered me when I saw it, because like very superficially, it's on some brotherhood tip. You know, like we're all alike, but then you think about all the complexities within the communities. And also, Jeff, really back to your earlier point about when we think about cultural appropriation, like, is this appropriation or not? This is a brotherhood. So isn't this a Punjabi singer and hip hop? And look, he's got, you know, he's all up in the community. They're playing dominoes. But it's complicated, because also the way Punjabis are seen within the context of India, and what is their class positioning, that they are building this brotherhood, and it's at the exclusion, at the expense of women. So it's invoking misogyny as well. There's a lot of physical capitalism in it, but, you know, and then there's like a desire in that video to draw allegiances, but it's almost as if it's without context, especially in this climate, in this moment in the United States, about, you know, all the racial justice that's being demanded here with Black Lives Matter. And we're, you know, nodding towards systemic oppression by acknowledging, you know, the effects of incarceration, you know, showing that object of the prison industrial complex is really powerful to see that in a video and who's watching this. So there's a lot going on there. And I think it's for Bhangra has a history, and it's very complicated in its reliance of hip hop. There is also, the idea that hip hop has appropriated South Asian sounds. I mean, it goes both ways. And I think it's the idea of our two disempowered communities trying to find some common thread. And whose expense does that happen? Is it at the expense of, is it like the common thread is we conquer white women, which is kind of what the lyric suggests and the visual suggests. So I'll just put that out there.
That's a great point. Jeff, did you want to respond to that? Because you've written so extensively on hip hop.
No, I just that these are really, Rekha will know, because we were both up in this in the 2000s. There was a lot of debate in the 2000s when, you know, artists like Eric Sermon and DJ Quick, Jay-Z, Timbaland were sampling Bollywood music, there was a lot of discussion back then about it. This is where the appropriation argument, there's two, maybe two quick points I want to make. One is a lot of times we talk about appropriation and we actually use the language of racial capitalism. So we actually say this is my culture and this is your culture, and we're going to draw a little fence around it, right? We're going to sort of own our culture, whatever we're going to define that culture as, and say, this is our culture, and on the other side of the fence is your culture, right? And I have a problem with actually thinking about culture that way. That's not how cultural practice works, right? And for us to define our culture as property actually reduces the power of it. To just what you can buy and sell. And we fall into that trap, I think, logically all the time around these kinds of debates. Oh, martial arts me, you know, like rapping you, you know what I mean? Like, and that's actually, it's not a real helpful way for us to be able to think about. So that's the first level. But then when we get into the questions of power relations and what it means representationally, and then also questions of interpretation, right? Eric Sermon used a lyric, Rekha, you could tell this story better than me. used a lyric that it was crazy for him to use.
The lyric. So basically just the short abbreviated version is there was a moment in hip hop where there were a lot of using of Bollywood and South Asian sounds. And most famously the song Addictive Truth Hurts. Eric Sermon sampled a Bollywood song, not knowing what the lyrics meant. And it talk about not context. And he said, oh, I didn't know anyone would know the song. And the song was actually a very popular song. And the lyrics, I think, talks about some sort of suicide or something. So it's very out of context. Similarly, Jay-Z rapping on a Punjabi MC song, his rap lyrics had nothing to do with the song. So these are mashes. And when we talk about, I think you're right, Jeff, about the fences. The fences don't work because culture is fluid. It spills. It's not isolated. It's not static. So the blueprint, hip hop is one blueprint. So, and as much as one could, you know, get annoyed and say, you know, they took X from us or what, there's a dialogue and a conversation that's happening with art. It's fluid. It's not fixed. You see something, you hear it, you play it. Now, most Punjabi songs, if you took out the vocals, would sound to you like just any old pop and hip hop track. So what does that mean? And is that fair to say that's just, it's not as polar or as binary is what I'm saying. And I think it's far more nuanced than that and complicated. And I think the idea of capital and what capital benefit it serves in the maker, creator, and is definitely at play here.
I also want to point out that it's a lot of the laws around this really benefit those in power, by which I mean even the way these are circulated. One of the examples I like to use, it's sort of, when image rights, you know, we always talk about fair use example, you know, when it comes up, but fair use is only good if you can go to court and argue it, you know, which is a lot of money. And it's certainly publications, most publications can't do that, for instance. So the laws have been situated away. So how do we grapple with that? Because what Jeff, for instance, what you're bringing in, I mean, is a much more, you know, complicated picture. But the way the media sort of works and social media and all these sort of different conversations, they do get reduced. So how do we resist that tendency to do a territorial sort of discussion, a discussion of culture as property?
I actually really want to hear what Wendy has to say about that.
Sure. Wendy, go ahead. What do you think?
I really resonate with everything that's being said, especially the fences. That's so great because I really feel like that's a product of, like Hrag said, colonialism and anthropology. Especially thinking about anthropology with the Native people. And I do a lot of research in collections, and I've just been completely humbled where I'll open up a drawer that's of Crow objects and I'll see something that's maybe Blackfeet or Lakota. And as a young Wendy, I was like, oh, Crows only do these things. And that has to get the hell out of that drawer. And then when I started really researching and learning, there's like a delegation photo of 1873 of all these Crow chiefs, and they're not wearing a single Crow moccasin. They're either Lakota or Cheyenne. And my head exploded to realize, like, I was just, you know, like siloing everything like this, like a white person would do. So to hear that, it's so true. But on the flip, I guess I kind of want to say, for Upsaloga, we definitely have a whole right system. And so for instance, like I'm wearing this elk tooth necklace and I can't just go and make this. I actually had to ask my aunt who has the right to make this so I could make it. And there are certain like designs in the community where if you made it and you didn't have the right and we knew about it, you'd get in big trouble. And there's something kind of really nice about that. But it, you know, it also can be annoying, but there's a whole policing system that's pre-contact that was happening for us culturally within our own art making, not necessarily if we were just really liked a pair of Cheyenne moccasins or something like that. So I guess I kind of wanted to bring that too, like just your own culture's way of sort of policing appropriation.
So Wendy, now when you see that object, you open that drawer and you see an object that might be Lakota in the Crow drawer, what is your reaction now? How do you deal with that?
Well, if it's good looking, then I'm like, yeah, we made the right choice. No, I'm like, it's our story now. It's definitely our story. It's part of our story. And even if it, like, let's say it was put in there by a mistake, like a museum worker put it in there, cataloged it wrong. That's actually part of the story too, misidentifying Native objects. So either way, it's sort of part of the story as well. Or it could be a collector came to the reservation and asked, you know, or wanted to buy some things, and we're like, here's a pair of Lakota moccasins, and then they get tagged in as a Crow, you know, and then I show up, I'm like, huh, what's the story behind this?
There's such an interesting thing there that you're saying too, though, right? Like, white man shows up, says, give me some of your things. Like, we're gonna like, whatever, like, I'm gonna take them, or we're gonna transact or whatever. I'm collecting this. And the folks, the Crows say, you can have the Lakota stuff, but we're not giving you our stuff, right?
Yeah.
And the thing that I wanted to kind of pull out there is here's where we shortchange culture when we put the fence around it, right? Cultural practices are actually bodies of knowledge, right? They're ways of preserving and passing on bodies of knowledge. Hip hop is actually a way of passing on knowledge, right? Bhangra is a way of passing on knowledge. The work that you're doing, Wendy, with all of your art and that kind of thing is a way of passing on knowledge. Like, we are all actually in that way passing on these bodies of knowledge. And when they get reduced to like these objects that go into a drawer in a museum, that's the danger in getting it decontextualized, right? Is that we're actually losing the bodies of knowledge that live around that particular piece. That piece, when you put it back into its context, it comes alive and it activates all this other kind of knowledge in the way that a word will within a language. And I think that that's part of the problem here. And so going back to the appropriation thing, because I know that we've taken it pretty far afield, right? The problem with the kimono exhibit, right? Going back to the kimono exhibit is that it's been taken out of this particular context, and it's now become a commodifiable object that's shorn of all the meaning that it had in that. And then when it travels, it lives in a new context, and for it not to be like relating back to the folks for whom that knowledge around that particular object is happening, but instead used to be able to further erase them, right? That's what the violation is there. That's the cultural injustice that I think the activists are trying to call out.
Yeah, and I sort of want to also cite, like, the cultural appropriation also works. There has been a, you know, for instance, people have pointed out that when you type in the word, you know, Cherokee, for instance, often it's the car that shows up, right? That's a form of erasure for people often talk about, where it's sort of like it's been so decontextualized where the word doesn't even show up anymore, right? In its proper context, even when you're trying to do a preliminary type of search. Wendy, did you want to talk a little bit about the use of Native American imagery in terms of the images you wanted to show?
Yeah, we could go ahead and pull those images up. So the image that is the full-length image, the photo, these are all two photographs of Chief Joseph, who is Nez Perce. And the one standing up is actually a trip that he took to meet with the President Hayes in 1879. And this is right after, pretty much after he fled. He fled from his territory in Washington with his people. He's trying to make it to Canada, and then he got caught. So then they moved his people to Oklahoma. So he traveled from Oklahoma to meet with the president. So that's what's happening in this delegation photo that was taken by Charles Milton Bell. And this was around 1879. So, and then the photo on the very right side is a photo that was taken in 18, I just want to make sure I get the dates right, 1877. in the Dakota territories. And this was right after his people were surrendered to the US in the Bear Paw Mountains in Montana. Anyways, the reason why I bring these up is the two images, the one that says Chief Joseph Nez Perce, that's in color, and then Chief Joseph Old Fashioned Fine Cut. These are actually tobacco trading cards. And so pretty shortly after these images were taken in the late 1800s, the tobacco companies started to use them as trading cards. And I found that really fascinating because the two photos actually really represent to me, you know, his attempt to really fight on behalf of his people to hold their territory, keep their culture, their language, and then for it then to be commercialized in this way to sell these different types of tobacco is fascinating to me. And it really kind of made me understand, like, since Native people were seen, you know, images of them were being used to sell products. And in the case of photography, this is what has happened. So it really kind of put into perspective how the history and how long Native images have been used to sell products.
Right, such a great point, absolutely. Jeff, I know that you wanted to talk a little bit about the notion of cultural justice and what that means. I wonder if you wanted to talk about that.
Sure, and so we could maybe show this slide here. This is our definition that we use of cultural justice, and we say that it's essential for racial justice. And so we've been talking a lot, I think, in terms of the restorative processes that we need to have in order to restore cultural justice. But there's a lot of terminology that's thrown around in the arts world about where we want to go with things. You know, we want to be able to achieve greater cultural equity, and we want to just make sure that folks understand what the stakes are, right? That the reason that we're at this particular point is because, again, cultural injustices have worked alongside slavery, genocide, marginalization, exclusion, segregation, to justify them, and also to further them, to seal them, right? To seal whiteness as superior and everything else as inferior. So we've got to heal and remedy what's happened, the injustices that have happened in that respect. And what we've been talking about here is being able to restore and create for communities of color ways of living, being, and sense making, restoring that, making sure that that's there, right? When you're taking an image of a great leader and putting them on a trading card, that's actually reducing and destroying in so many ways. It's a cultural way of destroying a way of living and sense making, right? On the other hand, as artists, in the way that Wendy does and in the way that Rekha does, there's ways to be able to take this and remix it and redo it and be able to express the humanity that's been taken away, right? To be able to have people move together in joy or be able to understand this is what has been done to us, but we're still defiant and we still are here, right? In all of these different kinds of ways. So it's also about being able to express ourselves and be able to evolve, to innovate, to be able to change, to continue to have our exchanges, to build these bodies of knowledge and to be able to pass them on so that we can be seen and live in our full humanity. And that in turn allows us to be able to really have a multiracial democracy. I just wanted to kind of throw that out there as something for folks to be able to kind of hook onto.
Yeah. Wendy, Rekha, was there anything you'd like to add to that? Any thoughts? All good. I also want to bring in, because we had a question a little earlier, Todd, I haven't forgotten, I see your question there, but I guess the conversation about monuments affirming whiteness, I think that's certainly been a huge conversation this year, certainly not a new one, but it's certainly become more mainstream than ever. And I think, I mean, does anyone have any thoughts about monuments and the conversation around that? Rekha, go ahead.
I mean, we can make a list of things that affirm whiteness, you know, like many, many things do. The names of sports teams, I mean, you know, turmeric, yoga, you know, there's no one thing. I think the museum is a very interesting project, and I think it's interesting that we brought it up. And, you know, I work sometimes in museums, sometimes it's an okay check. And especially in cultural spaces, I think, there's an attempt to sort of be diversity and to sort of be inclusive. And, you know, they do the brown thing one day and then they'll do this kind of programming. And, you know, as an artist, like, I think, you know, what I always want to keep the capitalism on the table in the room as well, is the necessity, or what is the necessity, or what is the relationship of needing to live in capitalism, in actual capitalism, you know, and how we, what can we do? And, you know, thank you, Jeff, for showing that, that slide. And that is hopefully, as artists, our attempt to get there and to be there, and just the daily challenges. And, you know, what Wendy had to deal with there is like, you had asked earlier about the strategies on how do you, like, you can't predict how racism is going to come at you. You can't plan for it. You can, as with experience, you can try to like cut it off at the pass sometimes, or stick your ground sometimes, but, you know, it's challenging. So monuments are important, and they are very physical representations of something. I mean, I just think of like Mount Rushmore is the most offensive thing ever created in the United States. So much sacred land is dismissed here, you know, is not acknowledged, let alone, you know, and it's unbelievable to learn these histories as an adult or later, to think that Mount Rushmore was this like idyllic, you know, display of like, you know, leadership or something, and to find out it's like the history behind that is really like it's painful, it's horrible. There's no shortage of you know, things that affirm or propagate whiteness. That's in many places. There's to that question. That's how I see it.
Totally understandable. So now, when it comes to cultural appropriation, and, you know, have there been any examples anybody would like to cite in terms of that they think were really successfully done in terms of really sort of engaging the community? Because I think we can all agree that cultural appropriation is worse when you're not actually engaging with something beyond the surface. Do you know? Because often the worst cultural appropriation is just sort of deals with things very surface level. Now, is there a way of actually sort of engaging that you thought was probably a very successful use of the sort of crossover, where you can respectfully work with material that is not culturally connected to your own history?
I feel like if you do that, if I was to put myself in that position, whatever culture I'm doing something with, I would want to be in partnership with that community, 100%, and almost them sort of leading the way on it. Otherwise, I would be too scared.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I'd have to say just the point, when I think about cultural partnerships, definitely with a profit motive in mind, but I think about the origins of the club night I did in New York City for 20 years based in Bhangra. It happened because SOBs, which is a venue in downtown Manhattan, they kind of understood early that you do it in partnership, whatever their programming was, and let people really curatorially and do all the things that feel comfortable for that community. So they had many successful nights that would not allow to exist in the city, including our night, and there were a couple of other, like there was a Haitian night, and just getting those people involved in the every aspect of it, not necessarily equitably in all realms, but I think you have to, you know, people have to be on the various decision-making levels of the project and not be brought on afterthought, after fact. And so it has to be a holistic conversation and a holistic process.
I also want to mention, for those who may not know, SOBs, I believe stood for Sounds of Brazil, correct? Just so, you know, people know that, sort of like the context for that a little
right.
bit.
And so. not from a Brazilian, from someone who... Yeah. You know, a Jewish American person who fell in love with Brazilian music on a like, you know, vision quest. So.
Oh, a lot to unpack there. Absolutely. Jeff, did you have something you wanted to add?
Just to say, I mean, I think it really points to having ethical practice, you know, like ultimately it's really about how you engage that yields the possibility of a true exchange, and an exchange that enriches both sides, that's not just sort of transactional but is transformational, and that's actually much more difficult than creating something that'll make money, which is, you know, probably hard enough. I don't know, I've never made money. So, but I think that the ethics of it is what this all kind of points to in the end. You know, we can't stop influence. We can call out ignorance and power that's being utilized to harm people, and we should. I think that's where what, you know, Wendy and Rekha are describing, like, is it's the beginning of kind of ethical practice, and it's hard, and it's easier, I think, to be able to draw the fence, to build a fence, or to justify building fences, than it is to actually have real engagement, and it takes a long time, and it takes a lot of investment, and you put yourself at risk, to be completely real. But it has to be done.
So before we go to the Q&A, I just want to bring up one more project. If you can put on the slide about Sam Durant's scaffold project. I wanted to bring this project up because I think it's an interesting example of the fact that this is a project where the American artist Sam Durant, who's white, had done this project for Documenta, which is a big art exhibition that takes place in Germany every 5 years. And it's sort of like closer to the idea of a remix, where it brings together different gallows from different executions. And the piece was very much about that, the history of capital punishment and executions. But one of the executions that's included is of the Mankato hanging, which was the largest public execution in US history by the government, and that killed dozens of people in Minnesota, in Lakota in Minnesota. And the work was purchased by the Walker Art Center in Minneapolis. And then when it was sort of ready to be installed, the local community, local Native American community, and many people may not know, Minneapolis is a very large urban Native American community. And they really protested this, saying, you know, it wasn't correct for him to be exhibiting this really painful, unresolved part of their history. So the museum actually started a process with the artist and the local community about this work. And the decision was made that the Dakota would actually not only get the rights to the project so that Durant could not actually remake this piece, but they were allowed to decide whatever happens to the piece itself. So in that way, it was sort of an attempt by a museum, some may say a clumsy attempt, but an attempt to really engage with the material and come up with some kind of resolution. I'm not quite sure if everyone's happy necessarily. I think the Dakota certainly has, at least their feelings were respected and their thoughts of this were respected and their own community in some ways. But of course, the fact that it had to get to this part is a little, obviously a problem. I wonder if anybody has any thoughts on this project in general, because it sort of represents how projects can sort of take on lives. I mean, this project had lived on for years until it got to Minneapolis without any, you know, protest. But then when it arrived in Minneapolis, it had a whole different life. Anyone have any thoughts on this and these types of projects where, you know, I mean, thankfully the artist was very open to talking and sort of transforming the project, but it certainly was not ideal, to say the least.
I think of Lincoln, because Lincoln was the one who
said,
go ahead and hang 38 Dakotas. So that's complicated in itself. And also, I also think of the American Indian movement, which was birthed there. So I don't know, the institution, like, that is not the place where you don't want to do something like that, the birthplace of the American Indian movement. And then I also kind of had a question about, when did the Jimmy Durham show? Was that after that happened or before?
It was around then, that's right.
And I feel like that there was a lot of tension around with that institution because of those two things with the Native community there.
Do you want to provide some context for Jimmy Durham, or do you want me to, just because some people may not know?
Go ahead.
So Durham, for many of that may not know, was a member of the American Indian movement, of course, the very influential activist group that emerged in the 60s and 70s, and also a very prominent artist. And there's been a big discussion of whether he actually has any Native American heritage. There's been a discussion within the Native American community. So there's been a lot of controversy, even though there's been, you know, and he exhibits within Native American spaces, but there is no, or at least there appears to be, nobody has found any evidence that his family actually were registered Native Americans. So, and that was an exhibition that was taking place at the Walker around the same time.
I also think that's interesting too, because then Jimmy Durham went to Europe and sort of had this flourishing, amazing career there. And the Sam Durant sculpture show exclusively in Europe and no problems there until context. So I think it was really, really necessary, both of those two things that happened. When was the pipeline around the same?
It was actually right around Standing Rock, and I think that's why this.
Yes.
It was right after Standing Rock had been broken up by the authorities, so I think there was heightened tension, certainly around the use of Native American sort of imagery.
So yeah, that really kind of like provided all this sort of fuel and momentum for the Native voice online, Native voice, which was quite amazing to see that. And then what I noticed being a Native artist is that a lot of institutions then started putting on sort of Native shows, doing things like that. Or if they didn't have Native art in their collection, they started collecting work. So the whole thing is like super complicated. But I don't know. I have mixed feelings on it. On the whole thing and how the institution sort of went about it. But I'm glad at the end that the community that did was involved in and heard.
Right. So I'm going to read a couple of the questions. So there's a question here. As Lisa said earlier, there can be discrimination of our own Asian American breed. How can colonial mentality among us colored people be decolonized? Ooh, okay, there's a a whole year project right there, just this conversation going on for a year. But does anybody want to tackle that a little bit?
Oh my gosh. I will just say that's the most painful thing for me at the moment, is having sort of that, is lateral violence or lateral discrimination. I think that's when I really realized, especially with my own community of Saliga, when we sort of beat down each other, then I really realized like how well colonialism is, you know, winning. So I feel like I'm in the generation now where it's really pivotal to sort of work that out and figure it out, because we'll just destroy ourselves.
Rekha,
I have no answer.
It's a tall order. How do we? I think it's tough. And I think back to Jeff earlier, like, you know, this is where intersectionality comes place in terms of within communities of, you know, things they're still, you know, we look at misogyny and casteism and class oppression, like these things all play roles in how we function within communities and cross communities. Some part of it is power and being disempowered. And that's what capitalism creates, is the sense of like scarcity and needing to fight for limited resources when we have to think in certain ways of like abundance. I mean, culture is abundant, even though and the other question I saw in the chat was like, should we get rid of museums, which is always a fun question and definitely like, I don't know if it's a fun question, but it's definitely a question, because is it just a cataloging of stolen goods at display? And that's a far deeper and more complicated question. I don't know. I think the whole system of the museum as a project needs to be examined and how it's funded and all of that. But, you know, it can be reimagined, I think, in some ways.
Right.
Rock, I just want to say, can I say something real quick? What I said was my defeatist self inside me. And now I'm going to come back. And I'm going to say, I think education is so important. Where I grew up on the reservation, I went to a public school. We never talked about Native history. We didn't even talk about crows. And crows were like most of the population going to school there. And if I think about my young self, and if I would have known things about our community, which I'm learning now as an adult, how much self-esteem I would have had about our community. And so I think education, we're only told one side still. My daughter, I've got a 13-year-old, she still doesn't learn anything about Native people. So education, and then having the empathy to step back and understand, like, we're all like very wounded people. Generations of wounded people, and having the empathy to step back and say, there be, you know, my own Apsaliga tribal member is doing this to me, but I know why, and I can have the empathy for you. And that's tough, that's a hard, but I think that's where I'd want to go, just really educating ourselves.
Absolutely. I mean, I often say decolonization happens at home. I think because it's very much, colonization is very much about interrupting intimate relationships. It's not just this kind of structure that was placed only on the outside. It really has sort of seeped into, I mean, frankly, our dreams, our families, our relationships, our lives, every little piece. So I often, when people ask me that question, I'll often say, well, it starts at home. Well, look around. How are your relationships formed by colonialism, by what you're studying, where you're working, where you're living, you know, and then start thinking about those processes and go from there. Jeff, did you have anything you wanted to add before we go to the next question?
No, go ahead. Go on to the next question.
Okay. So now there's a question. Interesting. This is an interesting question. Where does the notion of self-determination come in? For example, a person who is a quarter of a culture but identifies as such, how does that manifest in the artist's work, and how does one navigate that space and the in-betweenness? Context really changes the work itself and how the artist performs it. Now, does anyone want to address that? Because I think this is becoming more and more of a topic, you know? in terms of who gets to perform a certain kind of culture. And I mean, I can bring in my own sort of cultural heritage as someone who identifies as Armenian. Kim Kardashian is sort of one of the most famous examples, but she is only half Armenian, but there's like this sort of like idea of like, what does that mean for someone who hasn't been engaged with the community to then perform a kind of like Armenian-ness, for instance, as opposed to like, no one ever seems to know she's also like this sort of European Mayflower half of her or something. But there's this idea of like, who gets to narrate and under what ground. So does anyone have any thoughts on that aspect in terms of, you know, when people are sort of negotiating that?
Setting aside the blood quantum question for now, right? Which we could just go so deep into. I mean, this is where I think the aspect of cultural justice that's prospective, that's about looking forward, comes in, right? It's really about, there's an artistic level, and then there's this sort of cultural level. So let me start with the artistic level. On an artistic level, it's about developing your voice. It's about developing your practice, right? It's about finding who it is that you are. And that is going to be your journey. And that's going to be something that you'll have to figure out. But I don't think that waiting for somebody to tell you, you have permission to do it, is necessarily the best way to kind of approach that particular part of the question. It's your voice. It's the questions that you have. It's the experience and the legacy that you're bringing forward, that you bring to your particular practice. And so you make that decision. And you shouldn't let anybody else tell you otherwise. On the cultural justice level, when we were originally thinking about this idea of cultural justice and how to try to define it, mostly what we were thinking about was, how do we restore the injustices that have been done, right? The fact that I grew up as part of sort of the last mass generation that did, under which Hawaiian was not an approved language, right? That literally Americanization took place for most of the 20th century in Hawaii. And I was the last generation for which people were like, forget that. Like, we're restoring Hawaiian as a language. But I wasn't able to take Hawaiian or to learn Hawaiian the way that my nieces and nephews now can grow up and be fluent in it because of Americanization. Right, so we were concentrating on thinking about cultural justice in terms of restoring, but we were giving a workshop, and we were approached afterwards by a woman of color who is a ballerina, right? And she said, "Well, what about this? You know, I'm a woman of color. I feel like I'm here in what's traditionally been thought of as a European art form," which we could maybe say, you know, about a lot of different types of things, right? And how do I even see what cultural justice might mean for me in this? And that's where we were like, wow, like, we actually have to be able to allow ourselves the space and to think about cultural justice as perspective as well, as being able to express ourselves in all the ways, through all the ways that we can, and to be able to expand what it means to be who we are. And I think that that's something that we have to be able to claim that. And there's no formula, and it's ever evolving. And that's where we actually have the chance to be able to make a difference before our time is up.
That's great. Any final quick thoughts? Because we're about to wrap up. So I just, does anybody have a quick something they want to add? I think we're good. Okay. So thank you, Wendy. Thank you, Jeff. Thank you, Rekha. Thank you, everyone, for taking part. So Lisa, you have the floor.
Thank you so much, Hrag, Jeff, Rekha, Wendy. That was wonderful. I really appreciate this conversation. It was really powerful and so much to continue to think about. Oh, and thank you to our interpreters and our captioner as well. Before we close, I just wanted to say that we're going to drop the survey link into the chat box, and we'd appreciate it if you would give us your feedback. We will also email it to you tomorrow in case you do not have time to do that right now. And I also, before we go quickly, I just want to let you know that the third discussion in this series is actually taking place on January 14th and about this idea of actual capitalism and as a natural extension of cultural capitalism. It's talking about the funding mechanisms and philanthropy and the very challenging issues of diversity and marginalization and the language around that. And so we have a great panel lined up. So I hope you will RSVP and join us again on the 14th for the culmination of this series. So thank you all very, very much. I really enjoyed it.